Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Biz Essentials podcast. I'm your host, Veronica, and today we're going to be speaking with Patty Rogers. Patty is a growth specialist. She helps her clients automate their marketing and sales so that they can focus on what they do best. Today, we're going to be talking all about how you can automate your system from lead generation all the way through post-sales nurture sequence so that you can take that off your plate and focus on money-making activities without letting anyone fall through the cracks. Before I cut to the intro, guys, I wanted to let you know that since the recording of this episode, I have started using AWeber. I use the free version. I have clients who use the paid version, and it's fantastic. So I went ahead and put a link in the show notes. Full disclosure, it is an affiliate link, but it doesn't cost you anything extra, and it helps support the podcast. Anyway, this interview is chock full of great information, so stick around, and I'll be back right after this.
Tony Robbins once said, "No matter how many mistakes you make or how slow you progress, you are still way ahead of everyone who isn't trying." This is the Biz Essentials. You want to grow, get ahead, keep the spark. Here you'll get valuable insights and empowerment to grow personally and professionally. Isn't it about time you turn your dreams into successful passion projects? Learn how to be productive. Be successful, be joyful, and more importantly, be yourself. The Be Essentials. This is the Biz Essentials. And this is your host, Veronica of Veronica Ventures.
Welcome back, everybody. I'm here with Patty Rogers. Patty, I'm super excited to have you here. But before we get started, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and what it is that you do?
Absolutely. Okay, so super happy to be here. Thank you so much for the opportunity. My name is Patty Rogers. I run a small marketing agency. We work with female business owners primarily in the area of marketing automation. We run a marketing and sales agency, and the focus is all on business automation. So really taking business owners away from that overwhelmed, chaotic place that a lot of us tend to live in, into a more calm, predictable, essentially having a business that kind of runs in the background while you're doing the things that you need to do.
That sounds fantastic. You know, as an entrepreneur, I personally know how it feels to be kind of all over the place trying to get everything done, especially when you're a solopreneur doing everything yourself. How do you work with entrepreneurs and help them automate their business?
If I can go back just a second about what you talked about, it's something that I don't hear a lot of people talking about. And the biggest thing is, like you mentioned, solopreneurs kind of being all over the place. They get into business, their area of expertise, because they're super passionate about it. They're really good. It's just something that is very near and dear to their heart. It doesn't matter if you're a service provider, if you have a brick and mortar, it doesn't matter. Usually it's because you're really, really good at some one thing, right? And then what happens time and time again is the business of running the business gets in the way. Like, I may be great at, for example, business automation, right? And the technology behind that. But when it comes to running of the actual business, so the marketing, the operations, the sales, the fulfillment, the billing, all of that is what gets in the way for business owners. And that is a really slippery slope, especially for a solopreneur up to less than 20 employees, because there's something that shifts, right? As you're growing your team, you're still very much in the hands-on of all aspects of the business until you start to outsource those things. And you're really in the phase of overseeing a team and having them fully responsible and reporting up to the business owner. So the question was, how do I work with business owners in this area? So I work with business owners in a couple different ways. Similar to a lot of entrepreneurs, when I started out, I did primarily one-on-one type of work with business owners, which is very common. It's also very difficult to scale and grow your organization that way, because you only have so many hours in the day to work with people one-on-one. So usually where that leads people is to a place of burnout, because they can only give so much of themselves, or they have to just raise their rates continuously, right? Because there's only so many hours in the day. What I do is I work with business owners who are exactly right there. And typically what they're wanting to do is either develop some sort of a course, whether that be a self-guided, like an automated course, a drip course, a DIY, so a do-it-yourself or a done-with-you type of program. That's where I come in, because they know that they can't continue to grow and scale the way they're doing things right now. And usually that involves lots of things. It might be creating different programs so that people can come in and kind of go through like a product ladder is typically, or a value ladder is what it's commonly referred to as, but making sure that we have the foundation in place so that when a lead comes into our business, one, we're not losing that lead, because that's a big problem, especially for the solopreneurs, making sure that we're not losing those leads and that we can kind of systematically take them through a process so that they are getting to know us, like us, and trust us in the background. Like all of that is happening back here through smart email marketing. And so that we, the business owners, can be doing the things that can't be outsourced, like coming on podcast interviews and going and doing our social media promotion. Like there's only so much that you can outsource. And at the end of the day, the people that want to work with you, they want to work with you, right? Not like your social media person who's doing stuff for you, but like we have to get our face out there in video, in audio, in all of the forms, right? Not just like written text.
Right. That makes a lot of sense. And I can completely relate with the, you feel so passionate about something and that's why you get into the business of what you do. And then it's very easy to get bogged down by everything else that has to be done, especially social media or reaching out to all of these leads, hopefully, because we're really good at what we do. And so I can absolutely see the value in having a lot of that automated. When people come to you with whatever it is that they need. So let's talk about me, because it's all about me. I'm just kidding.
You're a female business owner. Let's do it.
I'm your target audience. All right. Yeah. So I'm a business consultant. I also do the podcast, obviously, because we're here. How do I know when it is that I need to move more to an automated kind of system? Or how do I know that I'm ready for something like what it is that you offer?
Good question. So when you talked about resonating, right, with the solopreneur and doing all of the things, there's something that I like to talk about. I touched on it briefly, which is there's really three components to running of a business, which is marketing, sales, and operations or fulfillment, however you want to use that last piece. But those are three buckets, right? We market, we sell, and then we fulfill, essentially. Where business owners get into trouble is mostly the first two stages. And so if we're killing it on the marketing side, which is amazing, however you do that, print, social, it doesn't really matter to me. But if you're doing really, really well on the marketing, that's fantastic. And then what happens is the marketing starts to work. Yay, that's amazing, right? So then we transition into sales mode, because if we're not selling, we don't have a business, we have a hobby. So when that happens, we transition into sales mode, then the marketing, guess what happens? We stop or we back off of the marketing. So now all of that flow of leads that should be constantly coming into our business is now drying up. We're in sales mode. And if we do a good job in sales mode, we convert those clients, right? Cha-ching, we're making money, which is also amazing. But then we get into operations or fulfillment mode, because now we have to fulfill on what we said we did if that's not automated. The problem with that cycle right there that I just explained leads to not following up with leads. And it also leads to the horribly familiar feast or famine cycle. Because if we don't have that constant flow of leads coming into our business, then we're here. We're like, woohoo, it's great. Marketing's working. I'm closing sales. And we're like, oh, my lead pipeline is totally dry. And that's a huge problem. That is a huge problem. And that is where automation can come in and fill that gap. The question that you asked was really like, how does a business owner know when they should automate and put some systems in place? That's a tricky question, because in my mind, you can't do it too soon. Like you have to be making money, of course, in your business. But if you wait, it's like anything else, right? It's time or money that we're going to commit to it later down the road. So either you're going to like stop everything, marketing, sales, and fulfillment, to take care of this piece that should have been done previously, or you're going to have to pay out some big money to have somebody do it. Whereas if you put those pieces in place, kind of like I said, as the foundation or at the beginning of the business, the early stages, it's a little bit easier to grow. And it actually helps you get to those levels that you're looking to get to. And that doesn't matter to me if it's 1,000 a month or 5,000 a month or 20,000 a month. It doesn't really matter, but it's going to help you get to whatever your individual goal is much, much faster if you have some of those pieces in place.
So if I understand correctly, it's never too soon to start automating because it'll help us reach our goals quicker.
It could be simple things that you do, like using a free CRM and having a lead magnet. I mean, there's some basic stuff that you can do, having a booking link. Some of those services are free. So there's lots of little things that you can do to add in some automation to your business until you're ready to kind of make that bigger jump of having like actual sequences and flows and funnels and all of that stuff working together for you.
So when someone is getting ready to set that foundation, as you say, and they want to make sure that they set up their business correctly so that they can grow as quickly as possible, what should we make sure that we do?
There are some foundational pieces that we need in place. There's kind of like the baby steps, like let's dip our pinky toe into the waters, right? Like having a way that you can email a massive group of people or your list is great. Usually that's you sending out an email to people and maybe you can schedule it and all of that stuff. When I talk about automation, what I'm talking about is a series of emails that go out well-timed, sometimes based on the people's interest, because usually you probably do more than one thing. You might work with people on their marketing. You might work with people on their sales. You might work with people on their mindset. You might work with people on offer creation. There's all different things, right? So we want to make sure that our marketing and we're speaking to them based on where they are in their buying cycle, because you might run across somebody in your business who's at like your little baby level, right? They're coming in, they're collecting all the freebies, or someone might opt in for your marketing who's way over here and is like, I don't have time to spend. I don't want to learn. I just want it implemented as soon as possible. So we have to make sure that our automation helps us to figure out where they are in our individual buying cycle. I hope that makes sense.
It does. Let me recap just to make sure that I got it correctly. So not only do we need to make sure that we have a system for capturing leads and drip emailing those leads, but it's important and good to make sure that we are targeting the right thing to the right group of people. So maybe a little bit of segmentation in that email system.
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely.
Interesting. I'm formulating a plan as we speak.
As you should. There's so many things to it. Like, and I like to use this analogy for people because I think it helps people to understand. If you are a service provider, coach, consultant, right? Those generally speaking are online businesses. The buying cycle is anywhere between 7 to 13 touches per person. Let's do a little bit of math and then we'll talk about another example. And most people that are in that space, coach, consultant, service provider, they don't need a ton of clients per month because they're usually a higher ticket sale. And then we get back into that, like we need to be able to fulfill, right, for all of those people. Let's just say 10 leads a month. Most people would be like, woohoo, 10 solid leads a month. That would be really, really good. Even if we use a base value of $1,000 per client. So let's say that we have 10 people per month and we'll use the minimum of 7 individual touches to take that person from cold prospect or cold lead to actual client. 10 times 7, we all know, is 70 individual touches per month we're talking about. Most of the people that I work with do not have the time or energy to make 70 individual touches. And those touches can be text messages, DMs, emails, phone calls. It doesn't really matter. But it's 70 individual outreaches. That's a lot for a solopreneur. That is a lot. And so what happens is maybe, and I'm being super generous, if the lead gets 3 outreaches, they're kind of considered lucky. And we know we're just letting money slip through the cracks. Like it's literally falling through the cracks. We're just letting it go by. And that's where automation can have the biggest impact. And that's why I say like, it's never too early. If you're leaving that much money on the table, that's a problem. Where it's different is if you think about like a brick and mortar, you're driving down the street and something happens and your car engine starts smoking, right? That's a situation where you need someone now. Your pet is sick. You need someone now. Like you don't need 7 to 13 touches, but when we are working business to business or even business to consumer in something like that, like I say, coach, consultant, service provider, you need to build that trust. And that's where we lose a lot of business. That's where a lot of business owners are just dropping the ball. It's really, really dangerous.
So how does automation kind of help keep the clients from falling through the cracks? What kind of things can we do to ensure that they don't?
Making sure that from the moment when they opt in, wherever they're coming from, ad, organic, website, anything, from that moment, We have to make sure that we're putting them through a sequence. And this is essentially what I build for our clients. So in my mind, there are 7 kind of foundational sequences or funnels that we need to have in place. And those really boil down to like your lead magnet, so your opt-in. And it's not just the delivery of the opt-in, it's the opt-in, and then it's some follow-up emails that go from there. And the way that I build them, they all kind of work together. There's points where people can come in or go out of different funnels based on the actions that they take or don't take. But usually what that boils down to is a lead magnet sequence, some sort of a welcome sequence. So as people are coming into your world, making sure they're getting to know you, like you, and trust you. Getting people on the phone, because a lot of us sell on the phone or via consultation, strategy, session, whatever you want to call it. The next one is making sure that we are reaching out and following up with connections that we make. Always makes me feel bad when I say it, but it's just the truth. A long-term nurture, which essentially is when people come into your world, we're asking them to take certain actions with us. If they don't take those calls to action at different touch points, then we put them into a long-term nurture where they stay until they buy or unsubscribe. It's a harsh truth, but it's a truth of doing business online. And then the last two are post-relationship. I call this the 3 R's, which is reviews, referrals, and repeat business. Especially with female business owners, they tend to not ask for the reviews or testimonials. It's much easier to have a repeat client than to go out and find another new client. I haven't quite put my finger on it, but there is something that happens that women are not consistently asking for those reviews and referrals. And not just like when we get the good ones, but making sure that if we do get one that's that we take the steps to correct that and to fix it. And then the last one, it kind of works in conjunction with the long-term nurture, but it's I call it a stealth sales sequence. Making sure that we're just doing some fun little things to get the prospect into a sales focused place without them knowing that we're doing it.
That sounds interesting. So each one of those 7 processes, if I understand correctly, each one of those 7 processes has its own sequence. It's not just one email, it's a sequence of emails depending on where they are in that process.
Yep. And the timing, all of that good stuff.
That sounds super interesting.
It's really fun. And a lot of it honestly is like I built it based on what I was struggling with in my business. It came from a lot of hard truths of needing to look in the mirror, but it's a game changer for small businesses. It really is.
What do you see as like the number one thing that business owners do to sabotage their growth?
I have coined this, trademark pending, entrepreneurial ADD. ADD is attention deficit disorder. Entrepreneurial ADD is basically that, but it's focused on our business. When I say that's the biggest mistake, it's because we are spinning our wheels on activities that are non-income generating. We are getting stuck in a place of analysis paralysis, right? Feast or famine, like all these things that we've talked about, overwhelm, imposter syndrome, inactivity, not showing up consistently in our business. Like those are the things that put us into that feast or famine cycle. And the way out is us doing the things that are a little bit uncomfortable. It's showing up consistently. It's sending emails, even though you don't know if people are opening them, and continuing to show up on social media, even if your post is not getting the likes and the comments and all of the things, because you're putting yourself out there. And that's the hardest part about being a business owner, is you have to put yourself out there, whether you know somebody is watching or not. And so when we're making that mistake, it's because we're letting all of those things that I just named off get in the way and sit at the forefront. Instead of like coming up with a strategy and sticking with that strategy, we get into spinning our wheels and trying every new little thing that we see online, right? We're like, oh, I need to do paid ads. Oh, I need to be on YouTube. Oh, I need to host a masterclass. I need to do a bootcamp. I need a different lead magnet. I need to do an automated webinar. I need to repackage my programs and price them differently. Like, these are the things that happen. You're laughing, which makes me feel like you understand what I'm saying.
Oh, totally.
So we're constantly looking at all these different strategies. And the basis of business is very simple. It's those 3 things that we talked about: marketing, sales, and fulfillment. But we get stuck in the shiny object syndrome of everything that's out there. And we're like, ooh, ooh, ooh. and we get distracted and we're not actually figuring out what works in our business.
I am totally 100% guilty of that, because I will be on social media doing my own thing and then I'll be like, ooh, that ad is amazing. I totally need to do that, squirrel. And then I go running off in that direction. Never mind the fact that I was supposed to be on there doing something specific. Right. And so I could completely relate. And I love the term entrepreneurial ADD, because I think a lot of us have that, especially when we're first starting out, because we want to make sure that we do everything possible to make sure that we're successful. And I think in that, we are sabotaging ourselves because we need to stick to something, right?
Yeah, we are. When I came up with that term, I was like, this is where people are struggling. It's what is leading to all of those issues that we talked about. And it really is. It's like all the things that I talked about, like renaming programs, repricing, restructuring, all of the things. Like there are so many things. And it's like, it's just basic. Find the people who need what you have, like know who you're talking to, solve their problem, and do a good job. Like that's it.
Right. And I think a lot of us get stuck in the everyone else telling us what is best rather than what it is that we do best. I think that's super important, because where that passion is, that's where not only your joy is, but also where your value is, because you have that passion for a reason, in my personal opinion.
And that creativity, like the way that, because honestly, like if we're really being honest, and I hope we can be honest,
of course,
like I'm guessing that the people on this podcast, yourself, myself included, like I know in my industry, I'm not the only one who does what I do. I would be willing to bet money that most business owners are doing something that someone else has done before them or is doing currently. They just do it in a different way. They attract a different person. They speak a different way. They look a different way, whatever. It doesn't matter. But people resonate with us. People resonate because the way that I frame it or the way that I talk about it. At the end of the day, we need to resonate with the people that we know we can help. And for me, that might be moms. And for you, it might be dads or millennials. I don't know. It doesn't matter. But that's what my whole point is, like what we do as individuals is probably not groundbreaking, like new technology.
Right.
I'm speaking generally, of course, like there are some people that are doing some really, really, really cool things. But generally speaking, like most of us, there are many people in our same field. That's why like people are hiring us as the individuals. Right. And the way do it, the transformation that we bring to the table.
I completely agree with you, because I was having that same struggle, because I was having coaches come on and speak. And I'm like, man, I have all of these life coaches. Is it going to ever get redundant? But then as I was editing the episodes, different things would just click. And I'm like, see, this is important, because yes, they might all be talking about finding their passion, but they're saying it in a slightly different way. And it might hit the right person just in the right way. And that's the way they needed to hear it to make that impact.
Yes. 100%. 100%. That also takes some time to get there as a business owner, to get to the point where you're like, I know who I work with and I know who I can help best. And it's okay. Like I think business owners are not saying that enough of I might not be for you and that's okay. And you may not be for me. Like it has to be a two-way street. In order to have like a really great relationship, both parties have to agree that it's a good fit.
Right. So if I understand you correctly, not only do we need to make sure that we have our target audience, so our avatar really focused in, but also what it is that makes us uniquely us and how we can meet those clients where they are and fulfill their needs. And if it's a good fit for both of us, then that's where harmony comes in. We become client and provider, service provider.
I'm sure you've heard this. There's a lot of people that talk about your target avatar and niching down. And I think sometimes, not always, you are the niche. What you bring to the table as the business owner, sometimes you can be the niche and that's okay. It doesn't have to be like, I work with women between the age of 35 and 55 and they live here and they go do this for fun on the weekends. It can be that, but it doesn't have to be.
Wow. So much to unpack. I want to know everything there's to know. This is why I love this podcast, because I get to ask all of the questions and I'm like, ooh.
I love podcasts. They're so fun.
I didn't even know that I was going to love podcasting so much. And then I started doing the interviews and I enjoyed it so much that I'm like, see, this is the universe stepping in and going, this is what you need to be doing.
Yes, we have to listen.
We do. And so you mentioned that female entrepreneurs don't necessarily focus on getting those reviews. And is there anything else that female entrepreneurs really need to make sure that they focus on, or at least put attention to, because it might be something that is holding them back?
100%. Like, my mind goes to two places. So consistency, I think, across the board is a huge problem. In however you want to refer to that, it could be emailing your list consistently, presenting offers, asking for the business, having calls to action. It doesn't really matter. You can pick whichever one of those resonates with you. No need to raise your hand right now, but I would go so far as to say that most entrepreneurs that are not where they want to be are struggling with consistency. So that's part one. And part two, and this could be part of consistency, is going to be putting themselves out there online. We know that video is amazing, right? It's nice to see people's face, to look in their eyes and see them smile. Like, that's a really nice thing to do. But there are a lot of business owners who struggle in that area for whatever reason, fear, rejection. Thank God women are now really working together, collaborating, lifting each other up, because it's such a beautiful thing when we work together. And there are a lot of female entrepreneurs, specifically, because we're talking about female entrepreneurs, that aren't showing up however they want to market their business. Doesn't matter to me. LinkedIn, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, doesn't matter. But they're not showing up. I don't know what the reason is, but I'm thinking it's all of those things that we talked about, right? It's fear, it's rejection, it's imposter syndrome, it's analysis paralysis, like being in a space of, oh my gosh, I have so many things to do and I haven't done like these five that were on my list from last week. So how can I possibly get on Facebook and go do a Facebook Live and drum up some business?
I'd be interested to know what it is about female entrepreneurs specifically that holds them back from showing up consistently. I know for me, it's often being perceived the wrong way. So for when you're asking for a referral, I don't want to seem as bossy or pushy or, you know, desperate. When it's not necessarily that, but I'm afraid that the other person's going to see it that way.
And that's exactly right. It's like, what is that? And I've heard this from business owners. They will say things like, I can't possibly ask for a review now because we just started working together. I'm going to say review, testimonial, put it all in one big ball. You just did something really, really great and the client's super happy. And then you're like, oh, I can't do it now. That seems like so arrogant or conceited, or like, I just did this amazing thing and now I'm asking them to you know, gush all over me with words or video. Or on the flip side, you're at a point in your relationship where things are going along well, but then you screwed up on something, or you didn't reply to an email in a timely manner, or you delivered a project late and you're like, oh, I can't possibly do it now. So now I have to work hard until I get up the courage to ask again. These are the things that people are saying. So what we need to do is have some automation in place so that those requests go out separate from us, right? We're not physically typing the email. We just have the stuff working back here in the background so that we know 45 days, for example, into our working relationship, that email is going to go out. And if they don't respond, another one's going to go out a couple of days later, whatever it is. But you get the idea. We need to have it be detached from us emotionally.
So if I understand you correctly, we want to make sure we have those systems in place, autonomous from what it is that we feel, so that we don't get in our own way. I'm going to have to set that up, because yes, it's so difficult. And I'll even have a client tell me face to face, like, oh my God, that was amazing. And then I want to be like, can you put that in writing? So I'm going to take that advice and I don't have to think about it. Before we wrap up, do you have any final thoughts, anything that we may have missed in our conversation that we as entrepreneurs or solopreneurs need to know about automation and making our business grow?
There are a lot of things that we can do to help our business. And a lot of times people struggle with, like, do I delegate certain tasks, like hire a VA, or should I add some automation? There's a school of thought that, like, hiring a VA is the first step that you should take. And trust me, I see the value in a VA. That's actually how I started like 12 years ago when nobody really knew what a VA was. So there is a ton of value there, but there are a lot of business owners who haven't quite figured out what they need to delegate. And there's a lot of business owners who are not skilled in managing another person. Like, they're still trying to manage themselves and grow their business. So in that aspect, yes, automation should 100% come first, because there's so much that you can do to free up your own time so that then you can really get into, like, clear up that headspace, get into that C-level mindset, right? Where you're looking at the future of the company, you're doing the planning, and then you can start to delegate to someone else.
So as business owners, as we become, or actually we should set it up foundationally, as we said earlier, but first start with the automation to free up the tasks that you can automate before you start delegating. Am I getting that correctly?
Yeah, absolutely. Most things that automation can do, a human can do, of course, right? That's kind of a no-brainer. But it's going to take them more time. It's going to take the human more time. So, like, let's really be strategic and think about how we can best utilize our time and our money, right? Because we're going to pay for both of those services, whether it's a VA and we're paying them to type the same bloody email 50 times or to save it as a template and send it out to all of those people. That's a lot of manual tracking and prospecting. Like, let's just take those 70 touch points, for example, right? 10 leads, 7 touches per lead. If you have a VA sending those templates, like, yes, they can templatize the heck out of things and they can have 7 different emails, but then they have to keep track of, like, oh, Patty's on email 2 and Veronica's on email 7. And when does she get it? And how many days? And they're, like, working on this Excel spreadsheet. Like, that logistically is a nightmare. But if you can have automation doing that for you, and it knows that I'm on email 2 and you're on email 7, which I think is what I said, and have it happen in the background, God, we're, like, utilizing our time and money in a really smart, strategic way.
Absolutely. Because even that example you just gave, that's only one of the email sequences, right? Because we have 7. So if I stop and make a purchase and now I need to be in a different email sequence, that VA would have to keep track of.
In a welcome sequence. Yeah. Now you need, like, a contract and an invoice and all of those things. But now we're getting into, like, really what happens, you know, 2-3 levels deep with automation and setting up those processes. But that's the power of it. It is really incredible. And it is the quickest way to put some systems in place to help you to grow and scale your business.
In just a moment, I wanted you to tell us where it is that we can find you for those of us who really need to get this automation in track and may not have the time to set it up ourselves, or the know-how for that matter. But for those of us who do want to do it ourselves, what system do you recommend that we get started with for that kind of email? Is there a particular software that you would recommend?
Yes. So I'm certified with Keap, K-E-A-P. I have partnered with them. So in terms of a platform that is as close as you can get to an all-in-one, and I'm not going to say it is a full all-in-one, because sometimes you need something else, right, in addition to, but it's pretty darn close. And so when I say all-in-one, what I'm referring to is it has your basic CRM functionality, which is a contact database, storing names, emails, phone numbers, and segmenting those contacts. So it has that whole piece, building of landing pages. That means you build the actual landing page and you have it hosted somewhere for your lead magnets, all of your email marketing, the marketing automation, which takes it to a next level, because then the system is thinking and saying, okay, if Veronica did this, then does she go here or did she go here? That's where the automation comes in. Invoicing platform, task management, your calendar is built into it. Tracking of your leads, like, it's a game changer. That's the only way I can describe it. For a small business owner, it is a game changer. So that's what I use and recommend. I'm a certified partner with them, which basically just means that I went through their process for them to say, yes, Patty knows what she's doing and we can trust her with our businesses. But there's a lot, and Keap is a great place to start. It's a low price point that's very comfortable. But for people that are just starting out in their business, there's a lot of free platforms that you can start to implement. They're not going to have the same power and functionality as Keap, but that's okay. You have to start where you are. That's what we talked about. Like, I would never recommend that someone use a software if they're not, let's just say, cash flow positive.
Right.
Like, if you're still struggling to meet the ends of life, then you're not ready for it. Then you need to stick with, like, free stuff. But as soon as you start making money and you're like, okay, I need some help, then it's time to implement. And I would recommend Keap. There's a 14-day trial that's available. from my website, and we take you through to really get you that quick ROI, get you in there using the system. So that would be my recommendation.
That's awesome. And I completely agree with you, because there are a lot of free CRMs and things like that. Like, but it becomes one of those like give and takes. Do you take the, it's going to do more things for you, so you're paying for the freedom, or you're saving the money, but paying with your time. So you have to kind of balance that out. And at some point, your time is worth more than the system costs.
Yep.
Right. So for those of us who need help doing that, where can people find you, Patty?
On Facebook and LinkedIn are the two platforms that I'm most active on. And then, of course, my website. One of the things that I love probably the most is talking with business owners about their businesses and strategy. So I am happy to chat with anybody who wants to have a conversation about some automation, have a quick chat, see if it makes sense to continue that conversation based on where you are in your business, because I love talking with fellow business owners. It is like one of the things that just lights me up.
That's awesome. And for those of you who want to get a hold of Patty, I will make sure to put her website and her social links in the show notes so that you don't have to write them down just now. So Patty, I want to thank you so much for being on the show. I learned a ton, and I know our listeners did too. And for those of you who want to get a hold of Patty, please check those show notes, and I'll be back right after this.
Guys, I know I say this all the time, but I learned so much during this interview. Automation really seems like the way to go, so I'm definitely going to be checking that out. Let me know what programs you like to use. And if you have any topic ideas for the Biz Essentials, I'm all ears. My contact information is in the show notes. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for joining me today, and I'll see you next time on the Biz Essentials.
You've been listening to the Biz Essentials. Thanks for listening to the show. We hope you've gotten some useful and practical information, learning how to be productive, be successful, be joyful, and more importantly, be yourself, and turning your dreams into successful passion projects. By listening to this show, you've already set into motion the most important part, starting. So it's important to catch the next episode. Make sure to like, rate, and review the show. In the meantime, hook up with us on social media at Veronica Ventures and at The Biz Essentials. Till next time, this is The Biz Essentials.
Today's quote of the day is by Michael Hyatt. He once said, "Automation is solving the problem once and then putting it on autopilot." And don't forget to share this episode with another entrepreneur who can use this information. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for joining me today, and I'll catch you next time on The Biz Essentials. Bye.